Song we just heard playing, the sun indeed has come up. It's a new day dawning. It's good to be gathered as God's people. The Lord has given us life and breath, and we're gathered here and we're watching recording of this service. We're going to give our breath in praise to the Lord this day, in this hour. So welcome to all those gathered here. If you're visiting with us, we're pleased that you are joining us this day as we worship our God, our Creator, together. I'd like to read from Revelation chapter 5, verses 5 through 12, as our call to worship. Then one of the elders said to me, "Do not weep. See, the Lion of the tribe of Judah, the Root of David, has triumphed. He is able to open the scroll and its seven seals." Then I saw a lamb looking as if it had been slain, standing in the center of the throne, encircled by the four living creatures and the elders. He had seven horns and seven eyes, which are the seven spirits of God sent out into all the earth. He came and took the scroll from the right hand of him who sat on the throne. And when he had taken it, the four living creatures and the 24 elders fell down before the Lamb. Each one had a harp, and they were holding golden bowls full of incense, which are the prayers of the saints. And they sang a new song, "You are worthy to take the scroll and to open its seals, because you were slain. And with your blood you purchased people for God from every tribe, language, and people and nation. You have made them to be a kingdom of and priests to serve our God, and they will reign on the earth." Then I looked, and I heard the voice of many angels, numbering thousands upon thousands and 10,000 times 10,000. They encircled the throne and the living creatures and the elders. In a loud voice they sang, "Worthy is the Lamb who was slain to receive power and wealth and wisdom and strength and honor and glory and praise." Those are perhaps familiar words to some of us. Those last words of praise, that song that they sing, "Worthy is the Lamb who was slain." We read that, we hear that when we celebrate Lord's Supper, which we'll do next week. Indeed, Jesus Christ, the Lamb of God who was slain, is worthy to be praised, and that's what we're going to do in this service. Amen. Let's stand together when the music plays and let's sing Lion of Judah.
To hell yet was raised up to reign and is born.
about you, but I look forward to singing that song throughout eternity, worshiping the Lamb before his throne. Amen. Receive a greeting from our great and glorious God. Grace and peace to you from him who is and who was and who is to come, and from the seven spirits who are before his throne, and from Jesus Christ, who is the faithful witness, the firstborn from the dead, and the ruler of the kings of the earth. Amen. Amen. Let's continue praising God, wonderful, merciful Savior, and there is a Redeemer.
Counselor, Comforter, King.
we read in our call to worship and sang in our opening song, Jesus Christ is not only the Lamb who was slain, He's also the Lion of Judah. He is the victor over sin and death. And as we turn now to God in a moment of prayer of confession, if we trust in the Lord Jesus Christ, we don't look to Him as our judge, the one who will condemn us. We look to Jesus as the one who advocates for us, the one who shed His blood for us, and the one who will declare us righteous before God's throne on that day of judgment. Hear these words from 1 Peter chapter 1, verses 13 through 19. Therefore, prepare your minds for action. Be self-controlled. Set your hope fully on the grace to be given you when Jesus Christ is revealed. As obedient children, do not conform to the evil desires you had when you lived in ignorance, but just as He who called you is holy, so be holy in all you do. For it is written, Be holy because I am holy. Since you call on a Father who judges each person's work impartially, live your lives as strangers here in reverent fear. For you know that it was not with perishable things such as silver or gold that you were redeemed from the empty way of life handed down to you from your forefathers, but it was with the precious blood of Christ, a lamb without blemish or defect. Let's turn to God in prayer and encourage all of us to open our hearts to the Lord, be honest, admit that you're a Savior in need, you're a sinner in need of a Savior, and look to Jesus Christ alone and His shed blood to save you from your sin. Let's pray. Lord God, your word is full of instructions on how you want your people to live. We just read a few of those instructions that Peter wrote to the early church, how we are to be self-controlled, how we are to set our hope on the grace that comes from Jesus Christ, how as your obedient children, we are not to conform to the evil desires that we had when we lived in ignorance. We pray, Lord, that we might be honest with you and confess that we don't live as obedient children. We still give in to the evil desires that are in us. We still give in to the temptations of this world, and perhaps we've done that this past week. No doubt each one of us did, each in our own way. But we come to you now, Lord, in prayer, and we ask that you would, Holy Spirit, give us hearts full of trust in Jesus Christ, that we would confess our sins to you and be assured that if we are honest and have contrite hearts, that if we repent, we find forgiveness in Jesus Christ by trusting in Him and what He did on the cross, where He shed His blood to save sinners from their sin. And Jesus, you rose victorious from the grave, and that victory is ours too. And we thank you for that. And this all is a gift of your grace, the grace that you give us by giving us faith in the Lord Jesus Christ. And so we thank you, Lord, for this wonderful gift. We pray this in Jesus' name. Amen. Remain seated as we sing Just As I Am, a few verses of this song as we continue to open our hearts before the Lord. I mentioned at the beginning of the service next week, we plan, we hope to, Lord willing, celebrate Lord's Supper. If you're with us and you believe in the Lord Jesus Christ, you'll be invited to partake with us. We don't come to the table because we're perfect. That can never happen on this side of heaven. We come to the table, we celebrate Lord's Supper because it reminds us that we need a Savior from our sin, and that Savior is Jesus Christ. That supper, that meal reminds us that Jesus gave his body and his blood to save sinners like each one of us. Just a few question and answers from our Heidelberg Catechism concerning the Lord's Supper. How does the Lord's Supper remind you and assure you that you share in Christ's one sacrifice on the cross and in all his gifts? In this way, Christ has commanded all believers to eat this broken bread and to drink this cup. And with this command, he gave this promise. First, as surely as we see with our eyes the bread of the Lord broken for us and the cup given to us, so surely his body was offered and given for us and his blood poured out for us on the cross. Second, as surely as we receive from the hand of the one who serves and taste with our mouths the bread and the cup of the Lord given to us as sure signs of Christ's body and blood, so surely he nourishes and refreshes our souls for eternal life with his crucified body and his poured out blood. So who are to come to the Lord's table? Those who are displeased with themselves because of their sins, but who nevertheless trust that their sins are pardoned and that their continuing weakness is covered by the suffering and death of Christ, and who also desire more and more to strengthen their faith and to lead a better life. The supper also is meant to strengthen our faith in the Lord Jesus, and by looking to him, surrendering and offering our lives to him, we will lead a better life through the power of the Holy Spirit, who lives and dwells within all God's people. So hear God's invitation and come next week to the Lord's table and celebrate Christ's goodness to us. Let's now stand together and sing Jesus, All for Jesus.
Jesus.
In a moment, we'll continue our journey through the book of Acts. I invite you to turn to chapter 24. Acts 24, page 1736 in the Pew Bible, if you're looking it up in that Bible. Today's passage and sermon will really be a character study, interesting character. We'll find out who in just a moment. But before we do, and before we read God's word, let's bow our heads and ask for his blessing. Lord God, we turn to your word and we turn to a section that deals with some unique characters in the history of the church. We pray, Lord, that as we study your word in this particular passage, that you would open our minds and ourselves to see ourselves, that if perhaps we find a reflection in these characters of ourselves, Lord, you would convict us of that and that we might change where we need to change. We would grow where we are growing in the likeness of Christ. But as we study your word, Lord, we pray that you would use it to shape us, that we would be more and more the followers of Jesus Christ. So bless this time, we pray. Holy Spirit, would you inspire what we read and what we hear? Inspire each of our lives so that we will surrender our lives to Jesus Christ and live all for him. We pray in his name. Amen. Acts 24, we'll read the whole chapter. 5 days later, the high priest Ananias went down to Caesarea with some of the elders and a lawyer named Tertullus, and they brought their charges against Paul before the governor. When Paul was called in, Tertullus presented his case before Felix. "We have enjoyed a long period of peace under you, and your foresight has brought about reforms in this nation. Everywhere and in every way, most excellent Felix, we acknowledge this with profound gratitude. But in order not to weary you further, I would request that you be kind enough to hear us briefly. We have found this man to be a troublemaker, stirring up riots among the Jews all over the world. He is a ringleader of the Nazarene sect and even tried to desecrate the temple, so we seized him. By examining him yourself, you will be able to learn the truth about all these charges we are bringing against him." The Jews joined in the accusation, asserting that these things were true. When the governor motioned for him to speak, Paul replied, "I know that for a number of years you have been a judge over this nation, so I gladly make my defense. You can easily verify that no more than 12 days ago I went up to Jerusalem to worship. My accusers did not find me arguing with anyone at the temple or stirring up a crowd in the synagogues or anywhere else in the city, and they cannot prove to you the charges they are now making against me. However, I admit that I worship the God of our fathers as a follower of the way, which they call a sect. I believe everything that agrees with the law and that is written in the prophets, and I have the same hope in God as these men, that there will be a resurrection of both the righteous and the wicked. So I strive always to keep my conscience clear before God and man. After an absence of several years, I came to Jerusalem to bring my people gifts for the poor and to present offerings. I was ceremonially clean when they found me in the temple courts doing this. There was no crowd with me, nor was I involved in any disturbance. But there are some Jews from the province of Asia who ought to be here before you and bring charges if they have anything against me. Or these who are here should state what crime they found in me when I stood before the Sanhedrin, unless it was this one thing that I shouted as I stood in their presence. It is concerning the resurrection of the dead that I am on trial before you today." Then Felix, who was well acquainted with the way, adjourned the proceedings. "When Lysias, the commander, comes," he said, "I will decide your case." He ordered the centurion to keep Paul under guard, but to give him some freedom and permit his friends to take care of his needs. Several days later, Felix came with his wife Drusilla, who was a Jewess. He sent for Paul and listened to him as he spoke about faith in Christ Jesus. As Paul discoursed on righteousness, self-control, and the judgment to come, Felix was afraid and said, "That's enough for now. You may leave. When I find it convenient, I will send for you." At the same time, he was hoping that Paul would offer him a bribe, so he sent for him frequently and talked with him. When 2 years had passed, Felix was succeeded by Porcius Festus, but because Felix wanted to grant a favor to the Jews, he left Paul in prison. This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. There are many words of wisdom and of warning in the book of Proverbs. And one warning that applies to someone in our passage today is Proverbs 16, verse 18, where we read, "Pride goes before destruction, a haughty spirit before a fall." When self-satisfaction and self-importance lead us, we will fall into the devil's traps. Pride is a temptation to trust in ourselves and not trust in God. And a haughty spirit leads us to think more highly of ourselves than we ought to. Haughtiness is the opposite of humility and being humble. Pride and a haughty spirit, these were what led Adam and Eve to believe Satan's lie that they could be like God. And people have been succumbing to pride and haughtiness ever since God put humans on the earth. One person in our passage who's corrupted by pride is Felix. Who is Felix? Well, historians know a fair bit about him. He and his brother were born slaves who became freedmen. They served in the government during Emperor Claudius's reign. Claudius appointed Felix governor of Caesarea, the province of Judea, not because of skill, but as a favor to Felix's brother. The Roman historian Tacitus describes Felix like this: "He practiced every kind of cruelty and lust, wielding the power of a king with the instincts of a slave." Ambitious slaves did whatever they had to survive, to become free, to get ahead in life. Murder and trickery, these were just tools to get ahead. Now, as governor of Judea, Felix has to deal with Jewish zealots. His role is to keep the peace at all costs. These zealots led revolts to try to free Israel from Roman rule. And Felix dealt with these uprisings with extreme violence, the history books say. He killed people indiscriminately. Felix's actions, his brutal actions, they only incited these freedom fighters to revolt even more. The Jews hated Felix for making Israel a dangerous place to live. So what do the people who had to deal with Felix have to say about him? Well, for one thing, they showed respect to Felix because he held the power to make or break their lives. Back in chapter 23, the commander Lysias writes a letter. He starts that letter by calling Felix his excellency. But the letter was more about saving his own skin, his own life, and his own career. Lysias distorted the facts about how he treated Paul. He says, "I saved Paul from the murderous Jews." That was only partly true. Lysias doesn't tell Felix that Paul had to plead for his rights as a Roman citizen. Lysias doesn't mention that he almost had a Roman citizen flogged unjustly, which would have been the end of his career. And now in our passage, we have Jews who come and they pour out pleasantries on Felix. Tertullus is the lawyer who speaks for the Jewish leaders. He's trained to speak. He's an oratician. He knows how to play the game in the court of a sadistic ruler. Let's look at what Tertullus says. He says, "We," that's Jews, "have enjoyed a long period of peace under you." Well, that was a lie. Jewish historian Josephus notes how Israel was anything but peaceful, with Felix's goons running around, roaming around, killing anyone who they believed might resist Rome's rule. Tertullus goes on, he says, "Your foresight has brought reforms to our nation." The proud Jews hated anyone who upset their national agenda, their way of life. Look how they treated Paul throughout Acts. Paul, who they think is a threat to their system of control and power, and he was. If the Jewish leaders are actually pleased with Felix's reforms, then it's only his reforms that gave them more power over the people. While Tertullus is not done flattering Felix, he says, "Everywhere and in every way, most excellent Felix, We acknowledge your wise and benevolent rule with profound gratitude. Everywhere and in every way, they're suggesting to Felix that he's like a God who rains down goodness wherever he goes. Tertullus makes it sound like Felix, he only does what is right. He's only done what was right throughout the land. These Jews are not grateful to be ruled by a fickle fool like Felix. Tertullus is spouting lies about Felix, and yet this governor laps it up. He loves the flattery. He loves people groveling at his feet. The former slave made good of himself. He enjoys the prestige, the honor that he believes he deserves. Tertullus begins by pumping up Felix's puffed up ego, and he does it because Tertullus needs to get his way. He knows how to play a narcissist ruler, and it works. Felix does not let the innocent Paul go free. Felix is proud. He's haughty. He's got a big head when it comes to himself. The historians write that he had three wives. One was a granddaughter of Antony and Cleopatra, pretty famous people in the Roman Empire. His current wife, Drusilla, is a daughter of King Herod Agrippa. Felix married for lust, and he married for political advancement. Felix gets what he wants. He gets who he wants. He does what he wants. He's so in control that he's out of control. At the end of our passage, verse 27, it says, 2 years pass, and Felix is replaced by Festus. Felix keeps innocent Paul in custody all that time. Why? Again, verse 27, because he wanted to grant a favor to the Jews. Felix lets justice slide to keep his grip on the Judean region. Felix treats Paul like another ruler treated an innocent Jew some 30 years prior to that. Remember Pilate? Pilate declared Jesus Christ innocent, but as a favor to the Jews, to keep them on his side, Pilate ordered Jesus' crucifixion. How often does justice take a back seat to political maneuvering? And God warns in Proverbs that Felix's pride, or as God warns in Proverbs, Felix's pride did go before his destruction. His haughty spirit did lead to his political downfall. Felix is not replaced by Festus because he's moving up the ladder. No, the tyrant Emperor Nero, a bloodthirsty psychopath in his own right, he has Felix removed because of his wild ways. Tertullus first pours out lies of flattery to ingratiate himself with Felix, while the lies continue. He pours out lies against the Apostle Paul. First, he accuses Paul of stirring up riots among the Jews all over the world. We read in verse 5. Paul didn't go all over the world. He didn't start riots anywhere in the empire. Tertullus overgeneralizes to make Paul look like a threat who he hopes Felix will eliminate. When we use words like always, everywhere, every way, all the time, we are usually overgeneralizing. Overgeneralizing, it stretches, it even breaks the truth. Now, we may overgeneralize by accident because that's a common habit in our language, but we learn this tactic of speaking at an early age. Think of your own kids or your grandkids. Kids learn to be experts at overgeneralizing with their parents. When they say stuff like this, "You never let me do anything fun." Probably not true. Or, "You always give my sister everything and I get nothing." That's overgeneralizing, and it's likely not true. People overgeneralize on purpose to make their claims more impressive. When we overgeneralize, it creates an emotional response in the people who hear us. Tertullus is a skilled, professional speaker. He knows how to use words to make people react the way he wants. If he can get Felix to believe that Paul starts riots everywhere, then Felix will likely execute Paul to get rid of him. Overgeneralizing is the same tactic that Tertullus used when he was flattering Felix. Remember, he said to Felix, "Everywhere, in every way, we acknowledge your great reforms with profound gratitude." Well, that's baloney. A few Jewish leaders may have benefited from Felix's reforms. They may have a bit of gratitude for that. But it was a lie to say that everywhere and in every way, They acknowledge his reforms with profound gratitude. Felix's reforms degrade the nation of Israel, the region of Judea. There's nothing profound about their fake gratitude. You're thinking, okay, why is he beating on this point? I'm beating on this point because it shows what Paul is fighting against. Paul's opponents fight dirty. They resort to fake flattery. They resort to word trickery to get their way. Language matters. Words matter. And as Christians, called to defend our faith in the Lord Jesus Christ against the world that hates him, we have to know how to take apart our enemy's false arguments. Paul does this in his reply. As I said, Paul did not start riots any or wherever he went. It was the Jews who started the riots. And so that first accusation, that is a total lie. Tertullus then accuses Paul of being a ringleader of the Nazarene sect. What's he doing by saying that? He's trying to portray Paul as a religious zealot who's leading a violent gang. Again, he wants Felix to think that Paul's people are rebelling against the Roman Empire. If Tertullus succeeds and gets Felix to believe this, then again, Felix will likely execute Paul like he's been doing to the zealots all throughout the province that he governs. Ah, but Felix, he's knowledgeable. He knows something about the people that he governs. He knows that the Nazarenes, they are no threat. He knows they follow Jesus, who said, "Do not strike your enemy." So that accusation really doesn't fly. And then we get to the third one. The third accusation by the Jews is a religious one, when they say Paul tried to desecrate the temple. Why try this religious angle with a secular ruler like Felix? Because the Romans allowed the Jewish leaders to kill anyone who desecrated the temple. There was a warning sign on the temple in Jerusalem that said, any Gentile entering the sacred courtyard would bear the punishment of death. The Romans would allow this, or they did allow this. But Paul is a Jew, and so the accusation is false from the get-go. Even if Paul brought a Gentile into the inner courts, the Gentile would be guilty, not Paul. Tertullus hopes Felix doesn't know the Jewish laws. He hopes Felix will believe that Paul has indeed desecrated the temple and that he'll allow the Jews to kill him if he doesn't himself. But Felix is married to a Jew. He knows enough about Jewish law. You'd have to, as a wise ruler. He knows Paul is a Jew. He knows Paul is not guilty. Felix should have ended the trial right there, right after Tertullus spoke. But we know he doesn't, and we know why he doesn't. He likes these flattering Jews who grovel at his feet. He also wants to keep the troublesome Jewish province calm so that he looks competent before the emperor. And with an air of arrogance, no doubt, he motions for Paul to speak. Paul expertly defends himself from Tertullus' lies. He exposes Tertullus' flattery and lie when he said Felix brought in a long period of peace. What does Paul say? He says, I know you, Felix, have for a few years been judge over this nation. He's already beginning to dismantle Tertullus' rhetoric. Then Paul goes on. He says, For 12 days ago, I entered Jerusalem. He knows that the facts will prove there hasn't been enough time for him to create mayhem that the Jews accuse him of, that he created mayhem or riots wherever he went. Paul's travel time, his whereabouts, they would be relatively easy to verify. He wasn't a private guy. He was out in the public all the time. Paul knows that he has truth on his side. He knows that the Roman commander Lysias, who kept Paul in custody for many of those 12 days, can attest to his innocence. While Paul changes his defense from defense to offense, he declares that he worships the Hebrew God as a follower of the way. Luke says Felix is well acquainted with the way. Felix is aware of how the Christians taught that Jesus fulfills the law and the prophets, the Hebrew scriptures. Felix would know that as a missionary of the way, the Jesus way, Paul went around promoting Jesus Christ. Felix would likely know, too, that the Christians claimed Jesus was resurrected, that he was the Messiah who fulfilled the Hebrew scriptures. Through Paul's defense, he proves that the Jews have no case against him. Well, Felix does adjourn the trial. He allows Paul many freedoms, but not his freedom to go. Paul remains in custody. Paul remains a defendant. But Felix is intrigued by what Paul says about the way, about resurrection from the dead. Being well acquainted with the way, he wants to know more. He's intrigued. He's interested. He wants to know about the gospel of Jesus Christ. As we learn, as I said, Felix's current wife is Drusilla. She's a Jew. He wants to hear more about this connection between the Jewish religion and this strange person named Jesus, the one they claim, the Christians claim, is resurrected. And so Felix gives Paul an audience to hear what he has to say about faith in Christ Jesus. Luke says Paul spoke to Felix about righteousness, self-control, and the judgment to come. Without a doubt, Paul explains how people become righteous, how they avoid eternal punishment by repenting from their sin and trusting in the Lord Jesus Christ. Felix responds to Paul's gospel message by being afraid. So why is Felix afraid after he hears about the gospel of Jesus Christ, which for Christians is wonderful good news? Well, Felix knows that he's living a life of sin and depravity. Maybe he fears facing God's judgment one day. But Paul offers Felix a way out of sin, a way out of death, a way out of punishment. The gospel message, as I said, should be a source of joy, not fear. Fear upon hearing the gospel, it also comes from not wanting to hear one's life or wanting to leave one's life of sin. Fear comes from the gospel's demand to stop loving the pleasures, pomp, and pride that this life provides. Felix rejects the gospel of salvation that Paul offers him. He says, "When it's convenient, Paul, I'll send for you." It was likely convenient when he was riding high on his pride and that gospel ultimatum couldn't stop his ego. It was likely convenient when he could block out what was required of him to receive salvation from sin. The ultimatum, the requirement of accepting the gospel, is giving up sin and fame and wealth and anything else that sits on the throne of our lives. But Felix's heart is fixated on those things. We know this because he keeps summoning Paul for 2 years. He didn't summon Paul to hear this gospel. He summoned Paul at convenient times in the hopes that Paul would offer a bribe, Luke records. A bribe from Paul. That would feed Felix's ego. It would feed his pride. A bribe offered would prove that Felix was still large and in charge. People like Felix cannot accept Jesus Christ. Their pride, their haughty spirit won't allow them to. But what about us? What's our response when we hear that to receive salvation in Jesus requires of us to repent of our sin? What do we feel knowing that the Lord asks us to turn away from the things of this life that control us, the things that take away our attention from Him? What do we feel knowing that the Lord asks us to surrender our lives to Him, to Jesus Christ? Do we just accept this in our minds as an intellectual thing, this truth about salvation? But then in our hearts, do we cling to this life that we love, which often has ourselves at its center and not the Lord Jesus? We've been studying Felix, not a great guy, but studying a character like this should cause each one of us to examine our own lives. We must honestly assess where our values rest and where our value as a person, as people, comes from. We may not be powerful like Felix, but we live in one of the most affluent countries in the world. A life of affluence, it's a tremendous insulator from recognizing the fact that we need a Savior from sin and all of sin's consequences. Through the gospel, Jesus comes to us. Through that wonderful message, He invites us to follow Him, not the ways of this world. Jesus, the light of the world, calls us out of the darkness into the light of His life. May it be true and may it be our prayer that the Holy Spirit will give us strength to answer the Lord's call and to keep answering Christ's call to follow Him. Let's pray. Lord God, the hymn writer writes, nearer, still nearer, Lord, to be thine. Sin with its follies I gladly resign, all of its pleasures, pomp, and its pride. Give me but Jesus, my Lord crucified. Lord, may that be a prayer that is on our hearts and minds and lips often, that we would be wanting to give up all the things that, of this world that entangle us, that take us away from you and following you, Lord Jesus. It's a tough world to live in. And the richer we are, the tougher it is. We see that with people like Felix, who had power and wealth. He couldn't give it up. And yet to be saved is to accept God's gift of grace. We don't like to do that, Lord. We're self-reliant. We're independent. We want to do things ourselves. But to be saved, we cannot do on our own. We need to accept your grace, Lord God. And to accept your grace requires us to let go of pride and self-righteousness. It requires us to admit that we are sinners in need of a Savior. It requires us to repent and surrender to our Lord Jesus Christ. So help us to do that, Holy Spirit. We can't do it on our own. That sin that lingers within us keeps us from doing that. But we pray that you would draw us out of the darkness and into the light, who is Jesus Christ, that we might live in him and he in us. That we might bring you honor, glory, and praise as we started this service reading and singing that song, Worthy is the Lamb who was slain. May our lives be a testament to you, Lord Jesus, that we love and serve you. We pray this in your name. Amen. Worship team can come forward. We're going to sing as a song of response. May the peoples praise you. When the music plays, I invite you to stand and sing this song.
Praise filled life.
Before we turn to God in prayer, just a few concerns to bring to your attention. Share our condolences with Gary and Sylvia and the family. Gary's mom passed away last week, and the funeral will be on Monday at 1 p.m. at Bethel Free Reformed Church in Monarch. It's open to all now that the restrictions are lifted. I pray that the Lord will be with you on that day. And just over a week ago, Barb Vector moved back to the Willow Creek. She'd been in Calgary for close to 3 years, I believe. It was a wonderful homecoming for Albert and Barb. She's come down now with an infection that's really wreaking havoc on her body and doesn't look good. So do keep Barb and Albert and the family in prayer at this difficult time. We prayed for Alita a few weeks ago. She's got ongoing issues with pain and with blood pressure going way too high. And we're trying to figure it out. It's been a tough go these last few weeks, and all throughout the last year she's had different things. So do keep Alita and her family in prayer too. Let's bow our heads and come to God in prayer. Heavenly Father, we thank you that we can turn to you in prayer, that we are not adrift on this ocean of life alone. Lord, you are with us. We can seek refuge in you. We can come to you at any time, in any place. Turn to you and open our lives before you, our hearts to you. And your word assures us that you hear the prayers of your people. And so we come to you now, and we have many concerns that are on our hearts, Lord. You know each one of us. You know us through and through. You know us better than we know ourselves. And we just pray that you would meet us in our time of need, that you would grant to us what we are in need of, Lord, and keep back what we desire, but you know won't be good for us. Help us to surrender to your will, to your ways, to your word, and trust that you, Lord God, our Creator, knows what's best for each one of us. It's a hard thing to do, as we've been talking about today in the sermon, and seeing a character like Felix, Lord, it's hard to give our lives to you. We ask that you help us to do that. Lord, we know most acutely, most intensely that we need you when life goes chaotic, when we become ill, when things don't go as we planned. We pray, Lord, that you be with the good hearts. Death is always an intruder, Lord, even when our loved one is well in years, Lord. Death is still an intruder, and it brings pain into our lives. And I pray, Lord, we pray that for the good hearts and their friends and family, that you be near them in these days, and be with them tomorrow as they go through the funeral and the burial of Corey. I pray, Lord, that you're near them and you give them hope. Hope that rests in Jesus Christ alone. Lord, we pray for Barb, and she's not well, Lord, she's ill. We pray for Albert too, Lord. It was such a wonderful homecoming to have Barb back at the Willow Creek and to visit with her and spend his days with her, and now she's come down with an infection, Lord, that has really wreaked havoc on her body, and she's in a critical state. We just pray, Lord, that your will be done. We pray that you be near Albert and give him strength and courage for these difficult days. We pray, Lord, that he and the family may have their hope rest in you, Lord Jesus. We thank you that Barb is a believer, and Albert too, Lord, and we pray that that faith in Jesus Christ will sustain them in these difficult days. And we lift up Alita. She's going through issues with back pain and blood pressure going very high, Lord. We pray that the doctors may be able to figure that out and to give her relief from what ails her. Lord, she's had difficult times in the last few years dealing with different things. We just pray that you be near her. Help her when she feels down. Give her courage and strength. And be with her family who seek to help her as best they can. And I'm sure at times feel helpless and they can't help her in ways that relieve her of her pain. Just be near them all, we pray. We ask that you be near with our seniors. List them, Lord, in our bulletin, Henrietta, Taya, and Ralph. Think of Hetty, Also think of Henny and Hermina, Lord, and there's others, not necessarily just seniors, but others who are dealing with the effects of age, the effects of illness, Lord. Think of Alex, who deals with AT. Be near him and his parents, Lord, and all of us, Lord, who deal with ongoing health concerns. As we started the prayer, Lord, help all of us to turn to you in times of need, but also in times of joy, times of plenty. As we sang in that song, Lord, everything comes from you. Each harvest is your own. The work that we do and the work that provides for ourselves and our families is a gift from you. Help us, Lord, not to be lost because of all the affluence that is around us. We may complain, Lord, but we really have no right to do that when we consider most of the world as less than us. So help us, Lord, not to rely on our stuff, but to rely on Jesus Christ and to keep everything in the proper perspective, Lord. We ask that you bless our church, our denomination, the church worldwide, that it may go forth boldly into the world and proclaim that Jesus Christ is Lord, and that peoples everywhere may praise the Lord God and may praise Jesus Christ, the Lamb who was slain. We ask this, Lord, and we pray all these things. Lift up those things that are on our hearts that you know are there. Lift them up to you in the name of Jesus, trusting that you hear and will answer our prayers according to your will. Amen. This time we're going to introduce a new song. So remain seated as we introduce this song. If you feel you can pick it up or you're picking it up and want to sing along, by all means do. Song will stand for the offertory prayer and the closing of our service.
You live, you reign, you think there's love in all. Father in heaven, thank you for bringing us here to worship you and to hear your words spoken. We pray that you bless these funds for one book and the others who also hear, so others may also hear and read your word in their own language. Be those who do the work of translating the Bible in these different languages, and bless the givers of these funds as well. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen. Receive a parting benediction from our great and glorious God. May your love abound more and more in knowledge and depth of insight, so that you may be able to discern what is best, may be pure and blameless on the day of our Lord Jesus Christ, filled with the fruit of righteousness that comes through our Lord Jesus Christ, to the glory and the praise of God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Amen. Our closing song, Now Blessed Be the Lord our God.